He is the divine, unchangeable God himself. No wonder he says he's immovable. No wonder that word comes up even in the Old Testament. In Malachi 3, he says, I am the Lord. I change not. Therefore, you sons of Jacob are not consumed. This means, my brothers and sisters, that he is the very perfection and excellence of God. He possesses the very attributes of God himself, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power. When he had by himself purged our sins, went back to the glory and sat down on the right hand side of the majesty. Verse 15 of Colossians 1 said, who is the image of the invisible God? The firstborn of every creature. Jesus Christ, watch this, is equal with God. I like that. Equal with God. Equal with God. That word equal, yeah, it means to be on an equal basis with God. To possess all the qualities and attributes of God himself. No, he says he thought it not robbery to be equal with God. Robbery to be with God. It's the picture of a thief seeking to snatch or take something that doesn't belong to him. But when Jesus Christ was on earth, he was constantly claiming to be God. Constantly claiming to be the Son of God. Constantly claiming to have the nature of God. Constantly claiming to be one with God. Constantly claiming to be on an equal basis with God. Was he a thief? Was he robbing and snatching the title of God? Or was he truly God? The answer is the most glorious truth. Jesus Christ did not have to rob or snatch to have equality with God. He did not have to rob or grasp the deity of God. He was already on an equal basis with God. Genesis 1 and 1 is replete with the fact. In the beginning God created. The word God, Zachariah Elohim, is plural in Genesis 1 and 1. Those who understand how the Bible is written in English, one is singular. English, two or more is plural. But in Hebrew, one is singular. Two is dual. Three or more is plural, which means that Elohim is plural, which signifies that there had to be three or more in the bara. Do I have this? Well, my brothers and sisters, I hear him saying, God, 10:30, he said, I and my Father are one. Jesus answered them, many good works have I showed you from my Father. For which of those works you want to stone me? The Jews answered, saying, for a good work you stone me not, but for blasphemy, and because that thou, being a man, makes thyself God. Jesus said unto them, there, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. In this text, Hillary, we see the sovereignty of Christ. In this text, we see the standing of Christ. I wish I had a witness in here. Do I have a witness? But I come together in this text, we also see thirdly the servanthood of Christ. Verse number 7, Christ emptied himself and became a man. Remember, we're dealing with the subject of humility. The fact that Jesus Christ took one great step down from heaven to earth. The step was so great and so far that theologians do not call it the humility of Christ. But theologians call it the humiliation of Christ. The sovereign God of the universe, he who existed in eternity and perfection. He who existed in glory and majesty. He who existed in dominion and power. Stepped down, just a little while, and became a man. But more than this, he was the one, my brothers and sisters, the Lord and Master of the universe. He deserved all the honor and the service of all living creatures. Took upon himself the form of a servant. Became the servant of men, not only of God, but the servant of men. Imagine, brothers and sisters, the Lord whom we serve, came and served us. The Lord whom we are to love came and loved us. The Lord to whom we are to adore came and adored us. The Lord to whom we are to wait upon came and waited on us.
That's right, hold on.
The Lord to whom we are to minister to came and ministered to us.
That's right.
The Lord to whom we are to seek.
Hold on.
Came and
God.
He sought us.
Hold on.
Between the majesty of Christ in heaven and the humiliation of Christ upon earth can never really be measured. Our understanding of the distance would amount to no more than a small bucket of water compared to the great ocean. But we're commanded to let the same mind of humility flow through us. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, we must study the deep humility of Christ and do our best to grasp and practice humility. Two statements in this verse need to really diligently be studied. Look, he said, number one, Jesus Christ made himself of no reputation. He emptied himself. That word empty, that's a new song. He emptied himself. Something means to completely empty. It is the picture of pouring water out of a glass until it's empty, or dumping something until it's all removed. The very picture of being completely empty, stirred, feeling of just how Christ had to go to humble himself for us. What was it that poured or emptied out of Jesus Christ when he left heaven and came to earth? My brothers and sisters, I need to tell you, that's what the theologians call the kenosis spirit. Look, my brothers and sisters, the passage doesn't say what he emptied. It doesn't say what he poured out. It just simply says he emptied himself. I need to tell you, that doesn't mean that Christ laid aside his deity when he came to earth. You see, he didn't lay it aside because he could not cease to be who he was. You see, he was God. And no person can ever cease to be who they are. A person may take on different traits and behavior, but a person, may change their behavior and their looks, but they're the same person in being, nature, and essence. You see, Jesus Christ is God. Therefore, he's always God. He possesses the very nature of God. But what he did was he laid aside some of his rights as God. Laid aside his right to experience only the glory and majesty, honor, and worship of heaven in coming to earth. I ain't ready yet, musician. Don't rush me now. He laid aside his right to appear only in heaven and to appear only of heaven.